Lecture 3, Magical Thinking in Adults. In this lecture, we will examine data from anthropology and psychology that show presence of magical beliefs in adults. I will present an experiment that examined conditions under which adults' skepticism towards magic changes for the belief in magic. We will finish this lecture by discussing clinical aspects of adults' magical beliefs. These are publications on this lecture. So, do adults believe in magic? The data of experiments with children predict that adults would be even more skeptical towards magic than were 9-year-old children. And indeed, when adults were repeatedly, 4 times, presented with magical effects similar to those earlier presented to children, they did not succumb to magical explanations. Yet, data from anthropology show that in most industrial cultures, there exist people who practice magical healing and offer other magical services in the media. The number of people who officially practice magic in England is in thousands. The field experiment showed that out of 51 pedestrians passing a ladder, 37 stepped into the road in order to avoid passing under it. In psychology, the data showed in the same direction. American psychologist Paul Rosin and colleagues showed that people's reactions to disgust and fear of contagion conform to the laws of sympathetic magic. Contagion, once in contact, always in contact, and similarity, the image equals the object. In these experiments, university students were reluctant to taste their preferred juice if a sterilized dead cockroach was briefly dipped in it. The students rated a sweater briefly worn by a person with AIDS as a significantly less desirable to wear than the one worn by a healthy man. Why do people react like that? Because our subconscious mind follows the law of participation. When engaged in participation, a person subconsciously suspends the borderline between his or her mind, for instance, feeling fear of disgust, and the real world, juice or a sweater that are perfectly suitable for consumption. But there is a problem with the above research. It only addressed magical thinking as it exists at the level of subconsciously based emotional reactions, when magic is not consciously processed. When adults are consciously asked about their belief in magic, they deny such belief. But what if adults' skepticism towards magic, like that of the children, is only superficial? Perhaps educated participants found it uncomfortable to acknowledge that they might hold the belief in magic. To investigate that, the experiment was conducted. The aim of the experiment was to examine if adults would remain skeptical if the cost of skepticism is increased. Participants were first shown a magical effect. A new plastic card became badly scratched in an apparently empty box after the experimenter cast a magic spell on the box, and then asked if they were willing to allow the experimenter to repeat his magic spell with their hands being in the box. Indeed, half of participants refused to allow the experimenter to repeat his magic spell and explained their decisions in the way that suggested they believed in the damaging power of the magic spell. In Lecture 7, I will present experiments which demonstrated that when the cost of disbelief in magic was further increased, denying the reality of magic might have affected participants' future lives, then almost 100% of educated adults behaved as if they believed in magic. Finally, as experiments reviewed in Lecture 10 have shown, In the situation of high cost, British participants exhibited the same degree of magical beliefs as uneducated peasants in central Mexico. Results strongly supported the assumption that adults still hold magical beliefs. These beliefs, however, can only be revealed in adults' actions and in situations in which not believing involves high cost. In their verbal judgments, adults deny that they believe in magic. Yet, as experiments reviewed in lectures 7 and 8 have shown, in regard to a special class of objects, fantastic objects and personally significant imaginary objects, such as the person's future life or destiny, even in their verbal judgments, adults succumb to magical beliefs. Now a few words about clinical aspects of magical thinking. Normally, participation magic is a useful, protective psychological mechanism. But if it goes out of hand, it can degrade into obsessive-compulsive thinking, an illusion that external events, which in fact are totally irrelevant to a person, have a personal meaning and are intended to harm or benefit the person. Clinical research showed that schizophrenic patients engage in magically based compulsive thinking to a considerably larger extent than non-schizophrenic psychiatric patients or healthy participants. There is a class of people who suffer from obsessive-compulsive disorder, OCD, which is a version of magical beliefs. To summarize, magical thinking is a specter that varies from useful reactions, such as disgust and fear of contagion, to clinical conditions, such as OCD and schizophrenia.